Over the last year, NASCAR's schedule has seen some dramatic changes. This year might be one of the most interesting years ever with the addition of tracks like the Circuit of the Americas, Road America, and the Dirt Race at Bristol. One of these races that was added to the schedule stood out to me, and that race would be the Ally 400 at Nashville Super Speedway. The story of this track is amazing. It is known as a track that once sat abandoned for nearly 10 years, and all of a sudden, finds itself hosting a Cup Series race in a triple header weekend. But this made me think of all the abandoned NASCAR tracks that have been left in the dust. Tracks like Rockingham, North Wilkesboro, and many more are rapidly getting worse and slipping farther and farther away from hosting a NASCAR race. For this week's video, I decided to take a deep dive into the history of these tracks and the state they are in today. Probably the second most famous track left behind in NASCAR's booming popularity during the 1990s and 2000s would be Rockingham Speedway. The very unique one-mile D-shaped oval hosted its last race in 2004 with a fantastic photo finish between Matt Kenseth and Casey Kane. The track is steeply banked with turns 1 and 2 at 22 degrees and 3 and 4 at 25 degrees, adding another unique element to the track. Rockingham is a multi-groove racetrack just like Homestead Miami Speedway, with cars getting big runs running the top side and cars gaining through the corners running the bottom. From 1966 to 2003, the track hosted two races a year at the NASCAR Cup Series level and ran Xfinity races from 1982 to 2004. In 2004, Rockingham hosted its last Cup Series race and Xfinity Series races, with Jamie McMurray winning in the Xfinity Series and Kenseth winning in the Cup Series. The 2004 Subway Fresh Fit 500 is one of my all-time favorite races, with interesting lane choices, a car-along flip, and one of the best finishes in NASCAR history. For the time being, it looked like a track would be done, but in 2007, Andy Hillenberg purchased Rockingham Speedway in an auction. 5 years later, in 2012, the NASCAR Camping World Truck Series would run a race at The Rock. Casey Kane would end up winning the inaugural Truck Series race, and Kyle Larson would win the next race, which would end up being the last ever at the track. Hillenberg cannot pay off the debts, and the track foreclosed and was once again in jeopardy of being abandoned. Despite how unique the track is compared to all of the other NASCAR tracks on the schedule, Rockingham has its flaws. The main grandstand seating in front of the start-finish line is very small, and as big as NASCAR is nowadays, cannot hold as many people as NASCAR would like. This forced Rockingham to add a majority of their bleachers in turns 1 and 2 and down the backstretch, and let's be real, who wants to watch a race from the backstretch? Another problem was the location of the track. Rockingham is located by the town of Rockingham, North Carolina, whose population is 9,910 people. Despite the small town atmosphere compared to tracks like Charlotte and Kansas Speedway, which are in highly populated areas, Rockingham is not located near a highway. The speedway is located on a very long two-way road called US Highway 1, and let me tell you, the word highway is very deceiving, as it is a very long and plain-looking two-lane road. Rockingham is definitely a track I would like to see on the NASCAR schedule, and as of now, the track does have plans for racing to return. Despite this exciting news from the speedway, I believe it is very unlikely that a Cup Series race will happen at the speedway anytime soon. But you never know, as I was almost certain nothing was going to ever happen at Nashville, and all of a sudden, I'm about to be attending a race there. The next abandoned speedway on our list is Texas World Speedway. Although NASCAR only raced here 12 years, it was still a track that was on the NASCAR schedule and was the first movement of NASCAR to go to Texas. The 2-mile D-shaped oval configuration is much like that of Michigan International Speedway, with 22-degree corners and a long front stretch that resembles that of Michigan. The NASCAR Cup Series raced here from 1969 to 1981 and had some legendary winners such as Richard Petty, who won here 3 times, along with Darrell Waltrip and Cale Yarborough. The track was classified as a super speedway when built and allowed drivers to run nearly wide open around the entire track. With a track within driving range of Austin and Houston, the track seemed ideal for NASCAR. The first inaugural races at the facility were a hit, but racing was much more popular in eastern portions of the United States, and as a result, attendance started plummeting early on. By the third time NASCAR had visited the facility, for a surprising second time in 1972, attendance for the race was only 33,000, which was very far below capacity. A year later, NASCAR got rid of the second race date, which was only on the schedule for 1 year, and replaced it with none other than Rockingham. Racing ceased at the facility from 1973 to 1979 due to the oil crisis, which sent electric expenses through the roof, and NASCAR would only race there 3 more times. After the 1981 event, Bill France announced that the now fading facilities and old track surface needed improvements and that NASCAR would not race at the facility anymore. After this, the track would hold some other events such as the ARCA Series, but for the most part, the track was slowly dying. As of now, the track is in dire condition, torn apart and holding vehicles damaged by Hurricane Harvey. Unlike Rockingham, I would think it's pretty safe to say the speedway is never coming back and will sit abandoned for years to come. Staying out on the West Coast, our next track on the list is Riverside International Raceway. This track is not only abandoned, but completely gone. This road course, located in Riverside, California, hosted the NASCAR Cup Series from 1958 till 1988, with 2 races on the schedule nearly every year. The track contained tons of history with drivers like Richard Petty, Cale Yarborough, David Pearson, Darrell Waltrip, Rusty Wallace, and many more historic drivers winning at the raceway. The track was very close to Los Angeles, which allowed many fans to attend the races and allow easy access to the track via highways. Attendance was never really an issue with the track, but safety was. During a 1983 IMSA race, Ralph Stommelen tragically lost his life when an issue with his car sent his Porsche into a tire barrier, sending it into a series of barrel rolls. Another race during the 1986 Chevy Corvette GTP saw another horrifying crash with the car of Chip Robinson nearly flipping into the stands. Nobody was killed during this crash, but it brought up the question of how safe the high-speed road course really was. Despite the terrifying wrecks the Speedway was known for, the most historic memory in my eyes was the iconic Dale Sr. pass on Jeff Bodine in 1987. This would be the second-to-last race ever at the track. As the population of LA skyrocketed, Riverside suddenly found itself in the middle of the suburbs. With the demand for housing rising, the Speedway was sold off to develop a mall and housing, and all of a sudden, Riverside was no more. The north end of the Speedway is now the Moreno Valley Mall, and there are zero traces of Riverside International Raceway. Moving to the east side of the state, just outside of Nazareth, Pennsylvania, was the Nazareth Speedway. The Speedway started off as a dirt track in the early 1900s and was purchased by Roger Penske in 1986. Penske built a pavement track on top of the dirt oval and opened it as the Pennsylvania International Raceway in 1987. Not long after, NASCAR started hosting Xfinity races at the track in 1988 and truck in 1996. Some of the more notable winners at Nazareth Speedway include Matt Kenseth, Greg Biffle, Ron Hornaday, and Martin Truex Jr., who won at Nazareth's final NASCAR race. Starting in 1987, the Indy Lights series also started to race at the track, and for the most part, the track had a bright future. In 2002, the future for the track seemed even brighter with the addition of the IndyCar series to the track, which still contained Xfinity and Truck Series races as well. Although the NASCAR and IndyCar series were quite successful, the Speedway was shut down in 2004 by the new owner, ISC, also known as the International Speedway Corporation. The unique low-banked racetrack was now abandoned, and despite Riverside, which is completely abandoned, the racetrack is in brutal condition and one of the worst on this list. The racetrack is overgrown with plants, and with no bleachers on the property has been vacant since its closing in 2004. Another track built in the late 1900s would be the Walt Disney World Speedway. Plans for the Speedway were brought about in 1994, and the track quickly broke ground on June 27, 1995. Built by IMS Events Incorporated, a branch of the Indianapolis Motor Speedway Corporation, the track was intended to be a new suitable Florida racing facility capable of hosting their new single-seater series. The racetrack was close to Disney's Magic Kingdom, but located so it would not disturb the residents as little as possible. The track was very unique and built with three low-bank turns, but not necessarily in the shape of a triangle. The track also had no permanent seating, which made it very unique. In order for events to take place at the Speedway, bleachers would have to be brought in and dismantled after the event was over. The track was most known for racing on the IndyCar side, hosting five races, including Tony Stewart winning one of them. The track only hosted two truck series of races, with Joe Ruttman and Ron Hornaday Jr. winning them both. NASCAR would have a very short-lived event at the Speedway, but the IndyCar series would keep pushing on. Eventually, though, the track would wear down and draw less of a crowd during the upcoming years. NASCAR would not renew their date with the racetrack, most likely because of restricted seating capacity, and IndyCar would search for a new date. IndyCar's original date was during January, and the race day created multiple washouts during the race weekend. IndyCar wanted to race on Labor Day weekend, but the Speedway would not allow it due to it being one of the peak times throughout the year at Disney World. Disney would officially announce that there would be no professional racing at the Speedway, and it remained a test center until the facility shut down in 2015. Another shortly lived stop on the NASCAR Truck Series schedule was at Mansfield Motor Speedway. This half-mile, low-bank speedway provided some great short-track racing over the years, with most notably Donnie Lea's three-wide last-lap battle between David Starr and Todd Bodine. Lea would become the first rookie in five seasons to win a race at the Truck Series level at the time. The track could hold 20,000 people with temporary bleachers added to the backstretch and was quite close to the city of Mansfield. The track hosted the Truck Series from 2004 to 2008 during Memorial Day weekend, but would lose its date despite the great short-track racing. NASCAR had already established some tracks in the Midwest, and in 2009, they decided to move its Truck Series race at Mansfield to the new Iowa Speedway. The track was later converted to a dirt track and was recently torn down in 2020. And last but not least, the most iconic and famous abandoned NASCAR track has to go to North Wilkesboro Speedway. This half-mile oval never failed to draw a crowd due to its classic short track racing and the stars that made their names here. Names like Allison, Earnhardt, Waltrip, Gordon all won here numerous times. With 14-degree turns, the track was almost a cross between Martinsville and Bristol and hosted two races a year for almost the entirety of the NASCAR races there. The Speedway hosted an outstanding 93 Cup races from 1949 all the way to its final race in 1996 with Jeff Gordon taking the checkered flag. The track hosted two Cup Series races a year all the way till its closing date in 1996. The only explanation for the shutting down of the Speedway was that it was simply bought out and replaced with the Texas Motor Speedway in 1997. In the 1990s, NASCAR was exploding. Dale Sr.'s popularity was peaking, and a young and upcoming superstar was catching the eyes of even non-NASCAR fans. North Wilkesboro had nearly been on the schedule for 50 years, but tracks like Charlotte and Bristol could each seat 71,000 fans and 86,000 fans. North Wilkesboro could hold 40,000 people, which wasn't too entirely small, but with outdated facilities, two other tracks nearby, and an unideal location, the Speedway was bought and closed by Bruton Smith, who intended to use the dates for tracks of his own, which would end up being the Texas Motor Speedway. Although the story of North Wilkesboro is a sad one, NASCAR grew too big for the Speedway and its location. The track now sits in terrible condition, seemingly untouched from the last day NASCAR raced there. Buildings are crumpled and the track is now flooding on the infield. Many people have voiced their concern for the Speedway, the most popular being Dale Jr., but the Speedway will have to be entirely redone. NASCAR needed to expand out to the West Coast, and with three tracks in Charlotte, the move seems logistical. But with most of NASCAR's fan base in the eastern half of the US, the move was controversial. I really hope that NASCAR can return to one of these tracks one day. Rockingham would be the most ideal in my mind and could possibly replace a track that has two dates so they could each get one. Although this would be a very tough task, in my opinion, NASCAR doesn't need seven road course races. The sport has been built around ovals, and if anything, I think NASCAR could use more short tracks or at least less than a mile and a half. No other track on the NASCAR circuit has characteristics like Rockingham and North Wilkesboro, and despite the challenges of where they are located, it worked out for NASCAR when the sport was at its peak. I hope you guys enjoyed the change up on my channel, and if you did, please let me know. I got a bit tired of making the same old compilation videos and had quite a bit of time this week to make a voiceover video. Thanks for watching, and make sure to like and subscribe.